Bat suit became a thing, election year, Epstein, Wuhan conspiracy, pandemic, quarantine, waiting for a vaccine, mask on, mask off, God forbid you need to call, homeschool, day drink, Netflix, potty train, toilet paper, out of stock, cooking meals around the clock, spring break never ends, social distance from your friends, Home Depot, renovate, new diet, overweight, Tiger King, what a shame, Carol Baskin is to blame, pandemic, no mistakes, murder, hornets, flying snakes,
the end of the world as we know it, it's the end of the world as we know it. It's the end of the world as we know it, and I feel fine. I feel fine.
And happy Father's Day, by the way.
But happy Father's Day to you, but Captain.
Thank you very much. Happy Father's Day to all the dads in the house.
That's right.
I got some good news and some bad news. The good news is Father's Day. The bad news is this is the last week of It's the End of the World as We Know It.
Yeah.
And if you haven't been here for this one, you can series, you can download it, or you can go onto our app and watch it, go to our website and watch the first two. We called it that because it is the end of the world as we know it, not the end of the world, but just as we know it.
Yep.
Because of what's been happening in our country for the last 4 months. First, you had the COVID, the quarantine lockdown. Now you have a lot of racial tension going on. And we think that to waste a good crisis would be a waste. that you can ask questions.
Don't tweet that.
You can ask questions so that you can learn from it and head into the future,
right,
and be better off for it. And so we've been asking questions. How can we be better off for what has happened?
I think the first week we said, don't let a good thing go to waste. Also, don't let a bad thing go to waste.
That's right.
We always have the opportunity to learn and to push forward.
Yeah, so we asked, because of the COVID, how could you be better off financially? That was the first week. And then last week we talked about how can you be better off relationally?
Mm-hmm.
And then this week we're asking, how could you be better for it personally?
Yeah, so personally is just saying we have an opportunity, right, when calamity happens, or any time, but we have our spidey sense going when tragedy hits, to ask questions about our worldview, and honestly, to ask questions about our God view. I think that if we're not asking certain questions right now, we're probably intentionally lazy.
Yeah.
We're intentionally avoiding it, because questions come up right now. Questions of, you know, the how could you let this happen, or like what's going on here? And I have friends who are asking me, who don't subscribe to this whole God thing, that are like, how could he allow this?
That's right.
And so we want to encourage, you know, the whole theme of this series has been challenge. You know, challenge yourself financially to ask questions. And now that we're talking about our God view, challenge yourself in that. Faith does not grow when we just sit there and nod along with everybody. Faith grows when we bring our fears and our doubts and our questions to God, and the relationship is deeper on the other side of that when you've been through it with God.
You know, it's a challenge is hearing someone your age use the word calamity.
That's good, though, isn't it?
Anyway, so the thing about it is that we didn't choose these circumstances, right? We didn't choose to be locked up for 2 months or be on furlough or lose our job. We didn't choose those things, but they chose us, and they left us with choices. And we can choose how we respond, all right? So our response to what happens to us gives us the opportunity to turn good things into bad things. It gives us the opportunity to empower us to change actually the course in life, to turn wrong things into right things. But the problem is it's easy to misunderstand how powerful our response is. And especially during crisis, you can lose sight of your ability to respond in certain situations and turn those situations around. And if you lose sight of that ability, chances are you're not going to grow as a person. But if you're intentional, you can become better. And let me just say this, if you're intentional with your responses, you can become better in almost every single arena of life. And that's because your response to your circumstances determines whether or not you're going to have a better future, whether or not you're going to be better for it. And I know that sounds like a big promise. You're like, that's a pretty big deal, Eric. But here's the reason why we tend to miss this. Your response that has the potential to reverse the natural course of things isn't natural.
Yeah, has to be intentional.
That's right. It's not intuitive. And so what we've been invited, whether you're a follower of Christ or not, but especially if you're a Christ follower, we've been invited to live this kind of life. Because think about it. If you're a Christ follower, the history of our faith is populated by men and women who faced hardship and unexpected circumstances, and many went through it successfully. In fact, think about the epicenter of our faith, a man named Jesus Christ who chose to surrender to his enemies, who chose to not defend himself. Mm. He chose not to save himself in order to save you, in order to save me, in order to save others. So what we're saying today is kind of our big idea. You're going to hear it throughout this talk is never underestimate the power of a measured response. Never underestimate the power of the measured response. And so what we're going to do is we're going to look at a biblical character that modeled this remarkably. And the reason why I say remarkably, we're going to look at him and we're going to see that he had a measured response that wasn't just a one situation, that he went through so many different circumstances where it was the end of the world as he knew it for him. But he had a measured response that went for over 40 years. Mm. And so what I'm going to do is when I read you to the end of this, when we get to the end of the story, you're going to see how this story illustrates the reversing power of a measured response. And so I'm going to go ahead and we're going to Quentin Tarantino it. I'm going to read you the very end of the story, and then we're going to go back to the beginning and
kind
of like, or Kill Bill. Any Kill Bill fans here? Nobody? There's an applause thing right here. You're supposed to applause.
It just stays flashing. Yeah. People should be clapping this entire time.
Now, many of you, so when I read the end of the story, some of you know this story. If you grew up in church, you probably heard it before. And I just want to encourage you not to disengage, because to disengage would be to miss the buildup of this story that allows us to see the power of a measured response.
Yeah, that's right.
So I'm just going to read it. This is how this epic story ends. With this hero of our story giving up. So just put on your imagination caps. We're Quentin Tarantino it. You're at the end of the movie, and this is what you see him say. He says this. He says, "You intended to harm me." This is out of the book of Genesis. "But God intended it for good."
So that line, when we were talking about the story just this week preparing for it, here's what hit me about that line just at face value. You intended to harm me, but God intended it for good. Two things. One was the intent of harm. I think so many times if God's going to do something with our efforts, it's when we try our best, we have good intentions, but our decisions aren't the best, right? And God goes, "Oh, that was cute. I see what you're trying to do there, but here, let me help you out," right? But this verse is saying, even when the intent is malice, even when we're saying, "I want to cause harm," even when we have evil in our hearts that we are acting out of, God still uses that and says, "I can still bring beauty out of that." And then the second part was just you intended to harm me. And I thought, through our stories, who are the different yous that we've had, right? So if you're watching here or in the room, maybe the you intended to harm me was an authority figure growing up, or somebody from your family, parent, uncle, whatever, or coach, maybe. And the you is you. And some of us have been in self-destructive patterns or addictions in our life, and we know the harm that we're actually causing ourselves and can't get out of it. And right away, God's saying, even if you intended to harm you, I can still turn beauty out of that, which is powerful.
That's
and
right.
Makes this story so much better.
And you might even look at it and say, the COVID, the quarantine, I felt like it was intended to harm me, but God can turn around for good. Or maybe you've been a victim of what you call systemic racism. God can turn that around for good.
Right.
So the hero of the story, obviously some of you know, is a guy named Joseph. Now, Joseph, we need to give you a little bit of history. Joseph comes from a long family that we would call the fathers of the faith. If you grew up in church, it was Abraham, okay? Abraham was the father of the Jewish religion as well as considered the Christian. Our roots go back to that. And then he had a son named Isaac, and Isaac had a son named Jacob, and Jacob had 12 sons, and Joseph was number 11 of the 12 sons. Now, Joseph was Jacob's favorite son from his favorite wife, which is a whole nother story.
We'll delve into that next
another
week.
Time, right. Yeah. So, and the reason why he was his favorite was because He was his favorite, but because he was his favorite, let me put it this way. Because he was his dad's favorite, his 10 older brothers couldn't stand him.
Oh, for sure.
Yeah. I mean, yeah. And one of the reasons why is because his 10 brothers were taking care of the flocks. They were pretty well-off family, and Joseph's job was to check on his 10 older brothers. How many know that doesn't work well, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hey, how y'all doing out here? Yeah. Eat a cheese sandwich.
He's the boy.
Ooh, that looks hot. You guys are sweating.
Missed a spot.
Yeah. Yeah. Anyway, check back on you in 2 hours.
And then one time he shows up and goes, guys, you won't believe it. I had a dream where all of you bow down to me. Probably not the wisest thing to say to your older brothers.
Yeah.
So they can't stand him. And this goes on and on and on. Finally, one day they see him as they're out taking care of the sheep. They're camping, you know, and they see him from a long way off. And they're like, man, I am so tired of this. I am over this kid. We need to do something. One of them's like, let's kill him. And the other's like, hey, that's a little drastic.
Hey, Robert,
here.
Let's pump the brakes there, buddy.
I thought maybe we white wedgie him or something, you know? But you want to kill him, right? But it goes, so they come up with this plan, and Judah, who's one of the, he's not the oldest, but he's kind of the boss, says, no, let's don't kill him. Let's just throw him into this pit, and then we'll decide what to do. So they throw him in this pit. They rip off his cool jacket that he had, an inside jacket
leather
that his dad bought him. Throw him down in this pit. They're there arguing about what to do. Joseph's sitting in this well or this pit. You know, he doesn't know what's going to happen. And they see some slave traders, some Ishmaelite slave traders going by. And they say, one of them goes, I got an idea. Why don't we sell him into slavery? You think your big brother was bad. I mean, right? So they do that. They actually sell him into slavery. They rip up his jacket. They slaughter a sheep and dip it in blood and say, hey, come home and go, Dad, Joseph never showed up. And on our way home, we found this. And so now his father thinks that he's dead. Meanwhile, he is on his way to Egypt, and that's where we're going to Quentin Tarantino it back to chapter 39. It says, now Joseph had been taken down to Egypt, and Potiphar, did I say it right?
I'm a Potiphar guy.
So.
But I'm not loyal to that.
Okay.
I can adopt Potiphar.
I also say cauliflower. An Egyptian who was one of Pharaoh's officials, the captain of the guard, bought him from the Ishmaelites who had taken him there. And maybe this is where Joseph's story kind of intersects with you, because now think about this. He is now a slave in Egypt, been sold on the auction block. There is nobody looking for Joseph, okay? And no. nobody's looking out for Joseph. The people that know he's alive, they're not saying anything. Everybody else thinks he's dead, so there's no reason to look for him. So here he is alone in a foreign land, nobody looking out for him. And maybe you feel that way right now. Maybe you feel like nobody's looking out for you. Nobody's even looking for you. You're just kind of on your own.
Yeah.
So I just want you to hold on, because I really think this story will help you. It says, so verse 2 says, and the Lord was with Joseph.
Right, which, you know, this kind of brings up this misconception that maybe some of our questions are surrounding right now, especially culturally, is the misconception is when God is with you, that things work out for you.
Yeah,
right? That's what we think. All right, so if God is with you, then, and I have friends who are like, hey, nice God.
Yeah.
Right? Like, or when something bad happens in my life, like, hey, where was God on that one? And that can be confusing, right? And we, a lot of times, our doubts or our fears are voicing to God saying, like, what, like, why not? Why are these things happening? And the truth is that God never promises that we won't have crappy circumstances. God right. never promises that we won't have tough times. Here's what he does promise. He does promise that we are not alone in the middle of them. He does promise peace in the middle of the storm. And so, you know, for you, I was thinking about my relationship with my wife. And God says, I don't promise that you guys are never going to fight, because we fight all the time.
Oh my gosh.
And it's all her fault. It's insane. Like, she's just always, it doesn't matter.
Why do you lose every time then?
Huh?
You lose every time. And it's her fault?
Yeah, she's strong, man. She's strong. No, but God doesn't say, hey, I promise you and your wife are never going to argue. He just says, I do promise that I can give you peace and patience and courage, and I can be kind of your foundation in the middle of your relationship. And so anyway, whatever's going on in your life, don't fall in this misconception nothing bad happens. We live in a fallen world, which means right. we all have free will. God gave us the power to make decisions, and a lot of those decisions are dark, And so we live in a world where there are dark decisions being made, but God says, in the middle of those, I will still be with you and I can still give you peace.
That's right. So you might be watching and maybe you've actually walked away from this Christian faith or walked away from God because you couldn't reconcile a good God
right.
in an evil world. And I just want to, we just want to say that maybe you left prematurely. Anyway, so back to the story. It says the Lord was with Joseph, but prosperity, success, faithful, fairness, justice wasn't with Joseph. The Lord might have been with Joseph, but it didn't look like it, okay? Mm-hmm. But just like we're talking about, he had this ability to respond rather than react, and Joseph chose to respond as if God was with him. So look what it says. It says, the Lord was with Joseph so that he prospered. Now, don't read too much into that, because here's what happens. He's now owned by Potiphar, and Potiphar sees that no matter what he puts his hand to is successful. It's like what he touches turns to gold. So Potiphar doesn't have him out in the fields or wherever. He actually has him in his house, and he becomes so blessed that Potiphar places him in charge of everything in the household. Okay, so there he is. He's working in the house. And verse 5 says, from that time he put him in charge of his household and all that he owned. And the Lord blessed the household of the Egyptian because of Joseph. To which I want to go, wait a minute. Where is justice in the world? Why wouldn't you bless Joseph? Why are you blessing his master? But Joseph models this response for us that's amazing. Joseph responded as if God was with him, even when it looked as if God had abandoned him.
Yep.
Now think about this. Unlike us, Joseph had no scriptures. He had no Bible. There was no religious materials. There was no angel showed up at his side and says, just hang in there just a little while longer.
Little cat poster
on the wall. Just hang in, it's Friday, you know. Nothing like that. You know what he did have? He had stories from his father, Jacob,
right.
about the faithfulness of God. He had stories from his grandfather, Isaac, about how God had come through for him. He heard stories about his great-grandfather, Abraham, and the adversity that he went through and how God had come through for him. And he decided that he was going to live his life as if God was with him. Because of those stories, he decided that he was going to live his life as if God was with him. And so here's the question that we want to ask you today. And that is, well, let me find the question. Here it is. How would someone in your circumstances respond if they were confident that God was with them? Think about this. No matter, and when I say circumstances, it could be your life circumstances, everything that's led up to this moment that you're here right now. Maybe you've had a hard life, or it could be something that's going on in your life right now, whether it be financial, relational, your marriage, whatever it is. How would someone, I'm not asking you to answer this, but how would someone in your circumstances respond if they were confident that God was with them? And I'm telling you, that's an important question, because this is your invitation to respond rather than react.
Yeah. And the reason I love the word respond is there's a difference between responding and reacting. I think for those emotional people out there, which is all of us, just the way that we react to it is different. But if you feel these emotions kind of well up inside of you and something happens, emotions are not a bad thing. Emotions are actually a beautiful thing. And so if somebody tells you you're an emotional person, that is a beautiful thing.
I am not.
That's an indicator of passion. But what happens a lot of time is that we react in the middle of emotion, which kind of makes our perception cloudy about what's the best decision at that time. So instead, take whenever you have an emotional, like the emotion come up, take that as an indicator of something that you care deeply about. That's a good thing, right? Emotion wells up that says, I have conviction inside of this. I care about it. But sit on that, process what that is that's welling up that emotion at that time until a point where you can make a measured response. Thank you. Measured response to it. So that question, if we respond as if God's with us, what does that mean? What would it mean to respond as if God is with us?
That's right.
For me, I think the opposite. How would I respond to something if I thought God wasn't with me? Yeah. What if I thought I was by myself? Like you said, like if Joseph was alone, you hear stories of people who are falsely imprisoned, like for life, and they're in prison and all their family dies, the ones who might know the truth, and then they just feel by themselves. If you feel like you're totally alone inside of a scenario and God isn't with you behind the scenes working good, then our desire is we have to control everything. If somebody says something false against us, we have to defend ourselves immediately because we have to look out for number one. But if we believe that God is actually with us in the middle of it, and then we say inside of that, God, can you believe this is going on? And God says, you're not by yourself.
Yeah.
You're not crazy. I'm with you. Your measured response needs to be love inside of this, and you trust that I'm working a miracle behind the scenes. Trust how powerful love is. I told you I'd tell you this story. This morning.
This is a surprise.
This is a surprise. This morning, so Gage, my 7-year-old, is at the age where he loves to see mom and dad kiss. Because he's like, I love to see you guys in love, right? And so he comes and jumps in the bed with us this morning. And you know, we're just kind of getting up. And he's like, he goes, Dad, do you love mom? And I was like, yes. He goes, I love you. Hey, mom, do you love dad? And she goes, yes. He goes, I love you. And then we're just sitting there and he goes, I'll bet the devil would hate this. Is that the sweetest? And something we said the very first week was that. That
there it comes.
Is, happy Father's Day. Is that love? Love is not passive, right? That love is the most powerful weapon we have. And I just thought, the measured response is always leading us back to ask, what does love require of us? Like, if we trust that God is working a miracle under the scenes, and he goes, man, what I'm asking you for is not to fight. I don't want you to grab a sword and start killing. I want you to love powerfully. Believe that love isn't passive, that it's powerful and that I'm working behind the scenes. Yes, first to cry in the message.
So we'll pick this up again next week.
Yeah. Beat where that one, pal.
Because it doesn't get better for this guy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's right.
See, everyone likes you.
I'm not making a reaction though right now because I'm emotional.
Everyone likes you better than me, Graham. Yeah. Because it doesn't get better for Joseph. It gets worse. In fact, it gets ridiculously worse. And it gets really complicated because Joseph finds himself in a situation that he can't win. It doesn't matter which way he chooses. It's going to be a lose situation.
Right.
There's no way out. Here's what happens. So Potiphar left everything he had in Joseph's care with Joseph in charge. He did not concern himself with anything except the food he ate. Now, here's the problem. Joseph was a lot like me. He was well-built and handsome.
It's like looking in a mirror here.
It does get better, I think. And after a while, his master's wife took notice of Joseph and said, come to bed with me. What? She was a smoker, and she was...
Hey, Joseph, the pajamas, lose them.
Now. let's just have dad jokes. Now, here's the problem. She owns him. This wasn't a suggestion here. This was a command.
Yeah.
He is her property.
Right.
So if he rejects her, he is done for. And if he follows through with it and her husband, Potiphar, finds out, he's punished. And in fact, you might feel the way Joseph does. You spend your life making sure you choose the right choices, make the right decisions, do all the right things, yet the wrong things keep happening to you. You begin to, you get to that point, you're like, why bother? Why try? Who cares? Why care? And in Joseph's case, there's no potential for a successful happy ending.
Right.
Because he knows either response will probably make him dead. It'll be the end of the world as he knows it, right? So, but in spite of that, he still chooses to respond rather than react. Because he says no over and over and over and over again. She keeps coming on to him. And then finally one day, she has him. There's nobody else in the house. She grabs him. He takes off running, but she ends up grabbing his cloak. So he basically runs outside naked. And there she is, humiliated, been rejected, and now she's holding his cloak. So she yells rape. She says, this servant, you know, her husband comes home, she says, the Hebrew boy that you brought tried to attack me, look, I have his cloak. Well, Potiphar, he doesn't know who to believe, but he has no choice, but he has to put him in prison. So verse 20 says, Joseph's master took him and put him in prison, the place where the king's prisoners were confined. So now he's in the royal dungeon, so to speak. And he is there paying the price for a crime that he avoided because he avoided it. I mean, right now, let's just do a little review of his life. Thrown into a pit, sold twice, kidnapped, sold twice, then accused of rape, and now imprisoned.
Yeah.
And the point being that we're trying to make is that bad things have been happening to good people for a long, long time.
Right.
Even people who God is with.
Yeah.
Now again, Joseph continues to respond as if God is with him, because look at this, the very next verse. But while Joseph was there in prison, the Lord was with him.
Yep.
And there it is again, right?
There it is again.
Yeah, like, okay. While Joseph was there in prison, the Lord was with him. It says, he, talking about God, showed him kindness and granted him favor in the eyes of the prison warden. Which, to me, this is a problem. It's a problem because here's our way of thinking. Our way of thinking is, if God is with you, you don't even know a prison warden. You know why? Because you're not in prison, right?
Right.
Especially for something that you didn't do. And I'm thinking there's times that, this is just me, I bet there's times that Joseph's going, you know, I wish God would just go be with somebody else, right?
Yeah.
Maybe he could be with Potiphar's wife. Or yeah. Maybe he could be with my brothers for a while. I'm kind of tired of all this whiff. Maybe
thanks
you can take
for the special treatment
yeah,
and everything.
Maybe take a little vacation, God, because it's getting too much for me, right? Wow. So anyway, now he's in prison. Months go by, years go by. Remember, no weekends off. I mean, Joseph is not going anywhere. Again, nobody's looking for him. Nobody's his advocate. Nobody is looking out for him.
Right.
But the same thing that happened with Potiphar happens with the warden, and Joseph ends up with favor with the warden, so much so that he kind of has his run of the prison. He's like, even though he's a prisoner, he's kind of second in command. So while he's in there, he's been in there for a few years, some prisoners show up that used to work for Pharaoh, okay? It was his cupbearer, butler, and his baker. And so he's serving them breakfast one day and notices that they look kind of down. He says, hey, why so blue, Panda Bear? And they're like, because we're in prison. No, they go, we had some dreams, and they were really disturbing, very vivid dreams. We believe they mean something, but we don't know what they mean. And Joseph goes, you know, God's given me that gift. I can interpret it. So the cupbearer tells him the dream, and he tells him, listen, that dream means in 3 days you're going to have your job back. You're going to be back working for Pharaoh. Well, the baker's so excited, he goes, hey, I had one too. And he tells him the dream, and it doesn't mean the same thing. And Joseph's like, yeah, it's not going to be, that's a tough one. I don't know if I can help you with that one. Because his dream, he goes, look, here's what your dream means. Instead of restoring your job, here's what this is going to what's going to happen, is in 3 days, you're going to be impaled on a pole, and you're going to be beheaded. Okay, that's good.
Is there more than one meaning to impale? Are you sure?
And by the way, the birds are going to eat your eyes out. Yeah, I could have done without
yeah,
that.
Yeah, okay? I get it. you die. That's fine.
So sure enough, 3 days later, that's exactly what happens. The cupbearer is restored to his job working for Pharaoh, and the baker is impaled and loses his life. Now Joseph is thinking, okay, this is going to work out, because he told the cupbearer, when you go back to Pharaoh, remember me. Tell him about a Hebrew boy. I was taken from my land, and then I was sold as a slave, and then I was thrown into prison for something I didn't do. And he says, remember me. But he doesn't do it. Okay? Mm-hmm. He doesn't remember him. And so even though everything that happened. But anyway, so we keep going on. Years go by. He's still stuck in prison. He's now probably in his 30s. Pharaoh has some disturbing dreams, and none of his wise men or magicians can interpret it. And so while he's there freaking out about that, the cupbearer goes, oh yeah, hey Pharaoh, remember 2 years ago when you threw me in jail? I probably deserved it. But there was a guy there, a Hebrew boy, that could interpret dreams. Maybe he can help you. So this is what happens in verse 40, chapter 41. It says, so Pharaoh sent for Joseph, and he was quickly brought from the dungeon. Mm-hmm. When he had shaved and changed his clothes, he came before Pharaoh. And Pharaoh said to Joseph, I had a dream and no one can interpret it. But I've heard it said of you that when you hear a dream, you can interpret it. And Joseph says, I cannot do it, Joseph replied to Pharaoh, but God will give Pharaoh the answer that he desires.
Which, by the way, is courageous, because at that time, Pharaoh considered himself a god and would teach all of Egypt to like refer to him as a deity and call him a god. So for Joseph to go like, no, God can do it, like,
yeah,
that takes...
I would have just said, yes, I can, right?
Yeah.
So So Pharaoh tells him the story, and Joseph interprets the dream. And the dream is this, the interpretation is this, that Egypt is going to have 7 years of abundant harvest, but then they're going to have 7 years of famine. But he doesn't stop with the interpretation. He, this little Hebrew boy, talking to the most powerful man in the world, says, and here's what you should do. Mm. And he gives him a plan. Well, Pharaoh is so stoked by this plan, he's like, is there anybody in my court that is as wise as this guy? No. He's a wise guy, huh? And so he says, I am going to promote you, another Father's Day joke, I'm going to promote you to be second in command, and I want you to carry out this plan. Well, the plan was brilliant. The plan was that because there was going to be 7 years of abundance, there's going to be a lot of extra crop, that the government would buy all the excess. And of course, when there's an abundance, you can buy it for pennies on the dollar. For 7 years, they stored away all of this grain. Then when the famine hit and people didn't have any more land, they started to buy it back from Pharaoh. But of course, the price goes up. So it's a win-win situation for Pharaoh. But the famine isn't just in Egypt. It's around all the whole region, even up north in the land of Canaan, where Joseph's father and family's brothers and their families are. They don't realize that Joseph is still alive, but they don't have any food either. So their father Jacob says to the 10 older brothers, why are you guys sitting around here? I hear there's grain down in Egypt. Why don't you go down to Egypt and find get us some grain? So the 10 brothers head off to Egypt, and when they get there, they bow down to the person who's in charge of distributing the grain, and guess who it is? Their brother Joseph. But they don't recognize him because he's in his 40s now. So they're bowing down to this prime minister of Egypt trying to get food, and he recognizes them. But remember, he doesn't react, he responds. So he just starts grilling them, asking them questions. Where did you come from? Tell me about your family. How many brothers do you have? Blah, 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 blah. And then he starts to kind of give them some tests where they have to go back and get their little brother and leave one there. And they're kind of, they don't know what's going on. Why is this guy treating us like this? Maybe we're being paid back for the time that we sold our little brother into slavery. And then this is when Joseph reveals himself to him. For chapter 45, in verse 3, he clears the room so there's nobody but him and his 10 brothers, and they don't know it's him. And Joseph said to his brothers, I am Joseph. And then his first question is my father still living? But his brothers were not able to answer him because they were terrified in his presence. Gee, I wonder why.
Yeah.
They were terrified because they didn't know what he was going to do. But Joseph lived almost every day of his life as if God was with him.
Right.
And now when it counted most, Joseph chose not to react, but to respond and forgive his brothers. And then this is what it says. It says, Joseph said to his brothers, come close to me. And when they had done so, he said, I am your brother Joseph, the one you sold into Egypt. Remember that? And now do not be distressed and do not be angry with yourselves for selling me here, because it was to save lives that God sent me ahead of you.
There's a phrase that we've said here before, and in my opinion, this story fits it the best. And when the phrase is it God or was it God's plan? I say, I don't know, but it is now. Maybe you've heard us say that before. And I, you know, said earlier, I have so many friends who are in the middle of this whole thing going on just with the country, just saying like, where is God? Like, did God want that to happen? Did God want this to happen? And there's some things I think that I can speak intelligently on, but still my default answer is always, I don't know, because I got a feeble human brain. And there's a little bit of a difference between that and the God of the universe. And so even the things that I think I can speak intelligently on, someone says, what was that God's plan? I go, I don't know, honestly, but what I do know is that God causes all things to work together for the good of those who love him.
That's right.
I know that as soon as something happens, God orchestrates a way to turn beauty out of pain. And you look at this story and you see, you know, hey, was it God's plan for his brothers to, you know, throw him into a pit and plan to kill him and the last second change their mind and sell him into slavery? It's like, I don't know. It doesn't sound like it would
right?
be.
Yeah.
It sounds like the brothers are just punk brothers, but I don't know, right? But as soon as it happened, it was, because God causes all things to work together for the good of those who love him. And was it his plan for Potiphar's wife to accuse him? All that stuff that happened. It's like, I don't know. But you continue to watch God's hand behind the scenes turn these broken aspects of our story, sometimes into the most powerful victories that we've seen in life. And this one, the craziest one, is that it has a hand in playing the greatest event that we've seen
in human
history.
Nobody really knew that this encounter, that the salvation of the world hung upon this encounter, because those brothers, they would be their descendants would become the 12 tribes of Israel, which would ultimately become the nation of Israel, and ultimately through the nation of Israel would come the Messiah.
Yeah.
Who would later do for the whole world what Joseph was now doing for his brothers. And that's why we want you to just remember this phrase, never underestimate the power of a measured response.
Right.
So the story wraps up. There's crying and hugging and tears and, oh my gosh, you're alive. You know, they're looking at his face like Peter, like, oh, I see you. There's that 17-year-old Joseph in a 40-year-old face now. And so they go back and they get their dad and they get all their families and they come back and they're living there. And then a few years into it, living there in Egypt, Jacob, the father, dies. And now his brothers are thinking that Joseph is now going to get his revenge on us. And that's when we come to the end of the story. It says his brothers then came and threw themselves down before him and said, "We are your slaves." They said, but Joseph said to them, "Don't be afraid. Am I in the place of God?" And here's where we get that famous verse. "You intended to harm me, but God intended it for good to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives."
Yeah, so don't know who needs to hear this inside of this room, you watching online, but in that situation right now, and I don't know if that is what's going on with our nation, is that that's the burden that you're carrying right now or feeling, or if it's in your personal life, but just want to remind you that you're not alone. You're not left to fend for yourself. You're not carrying that burden by yourself. Is that God is with you, and he goes, I promise you, if you continue to love, if you continue to respond with a measured response, that I will work behind the scenes and turn a miracle from your pain. So you can never,
underestimate
the power of a measured response.
So whatever you're going through, encourage you, just remember that God can, that your response can change the outcome of what you're going through.
And pray.
Yep, let's pray. Father, we're so grateful for your word, so grateful for stories like this that we have the luxury of looking back and seeing how you work things, as Paul said in Romans 8, that how you work all things for good for those that love you and are called according to your purposes. Mm-hmm. And Lord, there may be people watching and there may be people in this room. Some of us, we feel like there's been things that the intent has been to harm us, to take us down. But Lord, what they meant for evil, you turn around for good for your purposes, which cannot be halted. And so, Lord, I thank you for working in us, both the do and the will of your good pleasure, that we're able to respond rather than react. And so we thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen.
All right, we're running a little bit over. Sorry, guys. But we did want to include questions for you guys to talk about. So if you're watching online, people inside the room right now, you guys talk about this. We don't want this to be a consuming thing where we just go on Sunday, hear a message, and then nothing changes in our lives. We want to process this, right? We want things to be different, challenge ourselves. So here are questions, and then it'll be on the live stream so you can go back and...
Or you can just take a picture of the screen when they flash questions up here and use this to discuss when you go to lunch.
You are so smart, dude.
It's called technology.
I like it. Okay, question number one. Were your parents reactors or responders? How did this pattern work out for them and for you?
That sounds like Dr. Phil. How'd that work out for you?
Yeah. How's that working out for you,
That
whole reacting thing? Number two, how have you seen the events of your life be part of a bigger story? Has there ever been pain in your life that you've actually seen some good come out of? And then three, where are you reacting as expected rather than responding in a way that opens the door for an unexpected outcome? So love you guys. Love to spend this time with you. Hope that this challenges all of us to be able to think differently, worldview and God view.
Yep. We'll see you next week.
See you next week.